In 1928, Paul Dirac authored a paper while working with the Schrödinger equation and creating a relativistic version of it, and a prediction came out, that of the existence of antimatter, though he initially thought it might specifically be a proton. This surprised him, but for whatever reason, he didn't realize exactly what it fully implied. Now, this was not the beginning of the story of antimatter. The universe has always had it, and there were people suggesting it existed before then, but working with very different, now outdated models. But antimatter is real, and today we can make it in the lab. But the main work involving predictions of antimatter was actually J. Robert Oppenheimer, who wrote a paper in 1930 called On the Theory of Electrons and Protons, which was based on Dirac's work. It laid out that Dirac's prediction was in fact an anti-electron, not an anti-proton, today called a positron, and had the same mass as a normal electron. Positrons were then confirmed shortly thereafter in 1932. Feynman and Stueckelberg then stated their interpretation, that antimatter were actually particles with normal counterparts that were traveling back in time, a concept which is still used in particle physics. It must be noted here that scientists don't actually think that antimatter is time traveling to the past. It's just that it looks like that in the math. That doesn't mean it's an accurate description of it. It's just useful, mathematically, to express it that way. In any case, antimatter exists. And not only do we see it in the lab and use it in industry, nature itself produces tons of it. And that leads to one of the more obscure natural antimatter discoveries that now largely seems forgotten. In 1997, the Compton Gamma Ray Observatory detected positron fountains, huge amounts of positrons spraying into space and annihilating. There are at least two types of these known, and one of them at the galactic center extends a whopping 3,500 light years, producing an enormous number of positrons that are constantly colliding with normal matter, annihilating and releasing characteristic gamma ray emissions. The question is, what is the source? And that's where that story sits, with no real updates. We have no idea what's causing it. Could it be a product of a black hole environment? Unknown. But no black hole has been detected at the heart of these fountains. And the ones we do know about aren't currently doing this. And it really is a lot. These emissions indicate 10 million, trillion, trillion, trillion positron collisions in the fountains per second. That's hundreds of billions of tons created and annihilated in the time it took me to say this sentence. As an aside, I think the source of that much antimatter being created by nature for free, the most efficient fuel in the universe, should not only be pinpointed and studied if possible, but should also be subject to SETI searches. Only recently are there any SETI projects taking a serious look at the galactic center for signatures, because while the density of stars increases, the chances of seeing something does as well. The radiation environment of closely packed stars in clusters or the galactic center, however, seems to be a hard sell for indigenous life to arise on planets within them. Lots of supernovas going on in close proximity, for example. But for advanced technological aliens, it's not hard to envision them having a use for an enormous amount of free antimatter, sitting there for the taking, since it is the ultimate in efficient energy generation. So much so that it actually makes more sense than building a full-on Dyson sphere and harvesting the power of an entire star. Harvest the power of an antimatter fountain, and you might be better off. And it may not be as insanely huge of an engineering undertaking to do that compared to encasing a star. The big problem, though, with this discovery is that there just doesn't seem to be a visible source responsible for them. They're just jetting out, so that leaves a lot of stuff, save for black holes, off the table. And that said, since we don't know what the sources of these fountains actually are, that will greatly define what can be done with them in the future, if anything. But regardless, there's no question. The universe seems to have ways to create antimatter that we don't fully understand, but might serve as a congregation point for SETI searches. There have been more exotic ideas floated, such as white holes. But what little we can envision of that should be visible if it were there. It's not. Wormholes from somewhere else? No clue. But those do not appear to be easily created and sustained. So whatever it is, it's an unknown. But it has to be said that the fountains could also be remnants of something that happened long ago and no longer is. A positron floating through space can live indefinitely, as long as it doesn't encounter matter. And in a very deep vacuum like that of interstellar space, that could be hundreds of millions of years or more before that particle hits something by chance. And if you have a whole fountain spraying out, that's eventually going to clear out a lot of the normal matter in the path, meaning the positrons can overall exist longer. Not forever. Things move. And somewhere along the line, it ends. But again, it sure seems useful to have huge amounts of long-lived positrons for the taking. Another question here is whether dark matter plays into the creation of antimatter. But that would involve some sort of unknown interaction that we currently do not understand. But the mystery of antimatter has recently become deeper with a pair of discoveries that seem to present even more complications. The first was a very strange detection on the International Space Station of 10 atoms of anti-helium hitting the station. This is more than a simple positron particle. This is the nucleus of an atom. The instrument that detected it is the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer that's been running since 2011. And the main thing it studies is cosmic ray events, which this experiment has detected a lot of them, to the tune of 200 billion events so far. And they themselves were normal, just run-of-the-mill regular nuclei shooting across space. These 10 detections, however, were something more like an anti-cosmic ray of unknown origin. Here's where it gets complicated. From what we know of the Big Bang, there actually should have been a huge amount of antimatter created, the same amount as normal matter. And the universe actually shouldn't be here. It should have been annihilated. Instead, we have normal matter, which suggests that there is some kind of asymmetry at play that created slightly more matter than antimatter at the beginning of the universe. We don't know why that is. It's a mystery in itself. But with these anti-helium nuclei, it's not clear what could make them. To organize into that anti-atom, they would have to have been slow-moving, and there needed to be a lot of density there. So there was once a lot of this stuff wherever it originated. But that gets more complicated in that there were actually two isotopes detected, antihelium-4 and antihelium-3. Whatever created these particles like that just doesn't fit in with any known process. But there is one way: decay. So a decay event of a currently unknown particle might be at play here. This is a true unknown if this is the case and may hint at new physics. One option is that it's actually dark matter producing it, but there it would be unclear how something created in a reaction could end up traveling at relativistic speeds across the universe. One possibility is that it was an expanding cloud of plasma that might have done it, but we've never seen such a cloud of the type needed, and it would need to have been generated by a certain type of dark matter that contains a sufficient amount of anti-quarks to do it. Another scenario is something known as a dark dwarf. This requires dark matter to be complex, meaning that it has dark photons, dark electrons, dark neutrons, and so on. Since we don't know what dark matter is, we have no idea if it's like that. Get those crashing together, however, and there is a model that predicts anti-helium coming out of collisions of this kind of complex dark matter. And it's always possible that whatever generated these nuclei may be something even weirder, related to currently unknown physics. The second story is also interesting but a bit more explainable, and the two might be related. So this involves gamma ray bursts. The research team was examining spectrum data taken of a particularly bright burst, GRB 221009A, also called BOAT, as in the brightest of all time. Which is misleading because there probably have been many brighter ones going off before we could detect them. It is the biggest so far recorded by humans, however, and actually overwhelmed some of the detectors. So this type of GRB, there are several, is from a supernova. There was an emission line in the spectrum that was an unambiguous example of something that had long been suspected and hinted at with previous gamma ray bursts, that they have absorption and emission lines. But evidence for it was weak until now. The emission line lasted about 40 seconds, and it happens such that to create it, you need the collision of electrons and positrons. What exactly the mechanism was for creating the positrons isn't understood, but it seems like that with further research into gamma ray burst emissions, we'll get an answer. Antimatter is strange stuff because it is not speculative. It exists and can be created in several different ways, including the Big Bang, to the point that if we ever saw an antimatter galaxy that somehow survived this long, we actually would not be able to easily tell it apart from a normal matter galaxy. And antimatter is very simple. It's just flipping electrical charges. Yet the conditions surrounding its generation in nature are very mysterious, and we keep finding examples of antimatter where you wouldn't expect it, and that could easily take us into new physics from a place we might not have expected. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently concerned about the relationship between matter and antimatter. They really do not like each other, and perhaps might need some counseling. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.